I think any kind of creative discovery depends on having first been immersed in a huge sea of motifs and elements and ideas, and then recombining them in some way. I think the idea of a lightning bolt of inspiration hitting you out of the blue and a fully formed idea emerging is very rare or non-existent. I've been impressed by how much people in all kinds of fields have to do an apprenticeship of exposure to a huge number of ideas before they can accomplish anything original. If you talk to a novelist, they've read thousands of novels. If you talk to a good rock musician, they'll have an enormous record collection. If you talk to a scientist, they'll know a huge amount of information in their own field. For me, synthesizing ideas really depends on having a universe of ideas to recombine in the first place. And one of the things that means is not staying within your own discipline. Not only for me have I done cognitive psychology outside the boundaries of cognitive psychology by looking at linguistics and philosophy and literature, but even beyond that, in understanding the mind, you can't just do it within the straitjacket of psychology. As much as I love the field of psychology, it's a small subset of ideas, and that ideas of how our emotions work are as likely to come from an economist or from a game theorist as from a psychologist. Ideas about our sexual lives are as likely to come from an evolutionary biologist studying insects as from someone studying human beings in a psychology lab. So for me, it's very important that the traditional academic disciplines don't get in the way of finding ideas wherever they may be found, wherever they may live. As someone who works in the science of human beings, the boundary for me between science and other fields is kind of porous. What is essential in my finding an idea useful is that it come from someone who thinks systematically and rigorously and rationally, someone who cares about whether an idea is true or false. That's what someone who's interested in an explanation in why something is the way it is as opposed to some other way that it could be. For me, that's the essence of science. That's what's valuable about science. But it's not restricted to scientists, and things that used to be not science become science over the course of history, like my own field, psychology, as an example. I don't try to think laterally or just get inspired by some strange image from fiction or music. But I do take seriously ideas that might have originated from a novelist commenting on human nature, either directly in an interview or obliquely via a novel. I would care about what a historian might say, as long as they are doing so in the general mindset that I think of as scientific, that is trying to explain things and caring about whether the things you say are true or false. One example of how I've used ideas from other fields in my own thinking is a chapter I wrote on the emotions in How the Mind Works, which was heavily inspired by the political theorist and game theorist Thomas Schelling, who wrote a remarkable book in 1960 called The Strategy of Conflict. Schelling was kind of a Dr. Strangelove, among other things, a nuclear strategist of how you think through survival in a case in which you have to figure out what the other guy is thinking about what you're thinking, about what he's thinking, about what you're thinking, and so on. One of the things that Schelling pointed out is that there are certain realms in which a measure of irrationality and lack of control can actually work to your advantage. So for example, if you're negotiating with someone, let's say you're negotiating over the purchase of a car, and you'd be willing to pay anything between $20,000 and $30,000, of of course, the lower the better. And the car dealer would make a profit if he sold it at any price between over $20,000. So you'd both be better off at settling for a price in that range rather than walking away from the deal. On the other hand, within that range, the closer it is to 20, the better it is for you, the closer it is to 30, the better it is for him. How do you arrive at a figure? Well, it turns out the advantage goes to the person who's more irrational, stubborn, hot-headed, the person who would walk away from a deal unless he got the maximum. So a salesman who says, I'd like to sell it to you for 20, but I'm not allowed, my supervisor isn't here and he won't authorize me to go under 30, will get the better deal. On the other hand, the customer who says, well, I'd love to, but my hands are tied, the bank won't loan me more than 20,000, and so I can't pay a penny more than 20,000. That lack of control will work to his advantage. What's the analogy to human emotions? Well, often humans do things that seem to be irrationally stubborn. They vow undying devotion to their friends. They fight a duel or retaliate if they're insulted. They're hotheads, in other words. This is an example showing that it may not be irrational in some spheres of human life to be a hothead. To the hothead is the winner. This is also true in threats, for example. The problem with issuing a threat is someone calling your bluff. If they insult you or invade your space or chat up your girlfriend, and you say, if you do something like that, I'll beat you up, well, you could get hurt beating someone up. You might be better off just letting them have your lunch money or your girlfriend than getting killed in the process. The other person can anticipate that, and therefore they can act with impunity. How do you defend yourself against that dynamic? Well, if you're such a hothead that it would be an intolerable insult if someone took advantage of you and you had to retaliate even if it did you harm in the long run, paradoxically, that might be the most effective deterrent. They can't call your bluff if it isn't a bluff. This is all from game theory. No psychologist ever thought that up, but it might offer an explanation as to why so many of our emotions seem to be passionate and irrational. There may be a method behind the madness, and it took someone, not a psychologist, I think, to unlock the mystery of human irrationality and passion.